Well, do you remember last week we had you put the weight belt on and we showed the dumbbells and the bars because we said we're going to do some heavy lifting? Well, today what we're going to do is we're going to continue on that vein. We're going to continue on the heavy lifting reality of leadership development. We're going to talk about leaderships as it pertains to the church. And we're going to contrast cruise ships versus battleships. Now, historically, in the modern church, many people have viewed the church as a place for an organization to do something for them. Many people have viewed the church as an entity that would either bring them comfort, bring them economic help in times of downturn, bring them some kind of something that would ease their ills and woes of life. Many people have innocently viewed the church as something that the church could do for them. Now, may I just tell you that the church is not an organization. Write this down. The church is not an organization. The church is an organism. The church is not an organization. It's not a club. There's no secret handshake and incantations that we do. The church is not an organization. The church is an organism. The church is an organism. And many people have viewed the church much like a buffet line. You ever been to a buffet line? If you've been to a buffet line, wave at me, okay? You take your tray, you take your plate, you slide it among the things that are of interest of you, and you grab what you like, you pass what you don't, right? How many of you like buffets? I love buffets. The church ain't no buffet. And to greatly illustrate what the church ain't, we're going to show you a hyperbole. We're going to show you a hyperbole. A hyperbole is an obvious exaggeration. Are you ready for a hyperbole? Brother Bluto, show us.
And if this one could be with you, what a wonderful world this would be. Now, I don't claim to be an A student, but I'm trying to be. For maybe by being an A student, baby, I can win your love for me. Don't know much about history, don't know much biology, don't know much about a science book, don't know much about the French I took, but I do know that I love you, and I know that if you love me too, what a wonderful world this would be. La ta 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 ta. History. Biology. Oh, la ta 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 ta.
First Timothy chapter 6, verse 12. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 12. I would like us to read this verse out loud together on all of our campuses there at Silver Creek and Summit and in South Carolina where Jimmy is with his home group and in Palm Desert and here. We're going to read it together. Ready? Here we go. Fight the good fight for the true faith. Hold tightly to the eternal life to which God has called you, which you have confessed so well before many witnesses. Now, what we're going to go through tonight is an obvious comparison between the two ships, how people may have viewed the church. The church, zoom. The church ain't no cruise ship. The church ain't no cruise ship. Forgive the poor grammar. I'm saying it. Poetic license is mine. The church ain't no cruise ship. What the church is a battleship. The church is a battleship. Interesting reality about these two ships, 4,000 people on each one of them. On this ship, 1,000 people are paid to take care of every whim and need of the 3,000 others who are on the boat. On this ship, there ain't no room service. There's nobody catering to anybody. There are people on this ship, are we still zooming? There are people on this ship whose job is to paint railings, and they paint railings all day long. There are people on this ship whose job is to cook powdered eggs, and they cook those eggs all day long. There are people on this ship whose job is to man the guns, and they man the guns all day long. The church is not a cruise ship. The church is a battleship. Because see, the issue is not whether or not you're going to have fights in this thing called life. You're going to have fights. The challenge is identifying which of those fights are the good fights. Do you know where many people stumble? Is they're fighting fights that are not good fights. And do you know what those fights are? Exhausting. When you find yourself fighting fights that are not God fights, you are exhausted and fatigued and worn, right? We have to identify the God fights versus the good fights. God fight versus good fight. Matter of fact, above your battleship, write God fight. Above the cruise ship, write good fight. All right, here we go. In the comparison of these two ships, we want to talk about the core characteristics, what they promote, what they result in, how they view people, and the phraseology. Are you ready? Are you ready? Here we go. First core characteristic. In a battleship, the core characteristic is it's mission-oriented. It's mission-oriented. If you're on a battleship, you're just not bobbing on the water for funsies. The United States government pays you money to run missions. Even in peacetime, you're running a mission. On a cruise ship, it's just pleasure-oriented. The love boat, soon we'll be making another run. Remember the Friday night lineup? The love boat and Fantasy Island back to back. There's never been a better lineup. Boss, deep lane. I was so in love with cruise director Julie McCoy that you will never know how in love I was with her. Those two ships have different core characteristics, don't they? The battleship is disciplined. The battleship is disciplined. The battleship is disciplined. The cruise ship is unrestrained. Unrestrained. If you don't have the discipline of restraint on a battleship, you're going to be thrown in the brig. Or you'll be kicked out of the army, kicked out of the Navy. You'll just be booted out. But if you're on a pleasure boat, you're expected to be unrestrained. It comes with the boat. On the battleship, there's a sense of loyalty. On the cruise ship, there's a sense of frivolity. It's just frivolous. It's just frivolous. Kind of sit in your deck chair with your John Grisham novel, a virgin pina colada. Go from the hot tub to the pool to the Lido deck, to the promenade deck. It's just frivolous. On the battleship, you are there to serve others. Make no mistake about it, you're there to serve others. And on the cruise ship, you're there to serve yourself. So you see, when you look at the church through the lens, when you look at the church through the glass, when you look at the church through the glass of a battleship, it looks quite different, doesn't it? When you look through the lens of the church through a cruise ship, it looks way different. And the reason why the church has had so little power is that Brother Bluto is the captain. and he's sliding his tray along the buffet line. I like this about the church. Oh, I don't like that. We pass. Oh, I like this about the church. Oh, we don't like that about the church. There are core characteristics that make up the ships, the battleship versus the cruise ship. And those ships are critical that we have a keen understanding and insight. Now, there are two verses I want you to jot down because I won't have time to go through all the scriptures, but I want you to have them today. I want you to write down Acts 12:25, John 12:25, and James 3:16. Put those verses, those are for you to peruse and read as it reinforces the core characteristics. Acts 12:25, John 12:25, and James 3:16. What does it promote? What do the two boats promote? Well, here's what the first one promotes under the battleship. If you're part of a battleship called the USS Foursquare, what we promote is a sense of team. And what the cruise ship promotes is a sense of individuality. The battleship promotes team. The cruise ship promotes individuality. Matter of fact, here are the two phrases that typify what I'm trying to say. Under the battleship, you could write, "What do you want me to do today? Lord, what do you want me to do today for the battleship? God, what do you want me to do today for the church? What do you want me to do today for you? God, what do you require? What do you want me to do today for you?" Do you know that every day that I live, which is like each one, I wake up in the morning and here's how I start my day. "Good morning, Holy Spirit." It's the first thing I say. Tina knows this for 22 years. "Good morning, Holy Spirit. I dedicate my day to you. What do you want me to do for you today? Tell me and I'll do it." Now, under the cruise ship, what do you want to do today? Seems like a little subjective change, but it's the Grand Canyon. What do you want to do today? The cruise director comes along with all their clipboard of activities. What do you want to do today? Do you want to go ashore? Do you want to take an excursion? Do you want to practice the bungee jumping? What do you want to do today? It's all about you. It's all about you, Captain You Planet. What do you want to do today? See, the one is all about you being fulfilled, and the other is all about God and someone else being fulfilled. On the battleship, it promotes order. Hey, in the military, one thing I love about the military is it is very orderly. And anybody that's ever been to boot camp can tell you that they tell you how to shoot, shave, and shower. Some of you have heard that phrase before, huh? They teach you. You think you know how to make a bed? You don't know how to make a bed until you show how to make a bed. You think you can march in a straight line? You don't know how to march in a straight line. They're going to teach you how to march in a straight line. You think you know how to fold your clothes? You don't know how to fold your clothes. They'll show you how to fold your clothes. And everyone has there's a semblance of order on the military boat. On the cruise ship, there's a sense of randomness. So many churches that I know are in such chaotic disarray because there is not a sense of order at the leadership helm. And the polls of public opinion can be very, very intimidating, and the fear of man drive people to want to people please. How many of you know that? Right? The polls of public opinion are very important. You know what? I'm 45 years old. I've been doing this 25 years vocationally. I do not care if you like me. As long as I am doing what it takes to get you to your promised land. And how many of you know that you're not always going to like that? And you're not going to like me. You have enough friends. Right? Parents, your kids have enough friends. They have enough friends. Be the parent. In this thing called the church, there must be order to how the systemology works and operates. In the battleship, there's toughness. There's toughness. In the cruise ship, softness. Isn't that true? You want to put the, you want to get a little mani-pedi. You want to have the Hawaiian tropic for the savage tan. You don't want your skin to be leathery. Hey, honey, look at this leathery hide I got. Yeehaw! Heck no. You want that moist, glistening skin. And what a pleasure ship promotes is soft, tender skin. Tender skin. Write this down somewhere on the side of your margin. Tough skin, tender heart. Tough skin, tender heart. Because you know what so many people have in this world of leadership? I'll give you the breakdown. Many people will have tender skin, tender heart. And those people are always victimized. Aren't they? Tender skin, tender heart. And then people figure out, oh, whoa, 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 whoa. That ain't happening no more. So they get tough skin and a tough heart. And then they become the victimizer. And then there are people who try to mix it up and have tender skin and a tough heart, and they're just always conflicted. And what you need to have in this thing called the church as a leader for Jesus Christ is tough, leathery hide and a supple, tender heart. And you'll know if you're hitting the mark, if things can roll off your back, if you're not frustrated easily, if you're not wounded easily, but you have tough skin, things roll off, but you still feel and can forgive. That's how you tell whether or not you're operating with tough skin, tender heart. On the battleship, it promotes fulfillment. Fulfillment. If you ask every person you know, if you ask every person you know, and you gave them the option, would you rather have $10,000 or be absolutely fulfilled? There are a couple knuckleheads that'll take the cash. But they're really knuckleheads. If you could wave a wand and say, you're going to be fulfilled in everything you put your hand to for the rest of your life, we'll give you $10,000. But you can't have both. Which one? People want to be fulfilled. You know what people want? They want purpose. Why am I here? What's my purpose on this earth? Why am I drawing breath? What am I here for? Come on, have you ever asked yourself that question? What am I doing? What's the best use of me? Is this really the best use of me? Really? And so many people are so unfulfilled because they're not diving into the battleship of the church. It's not an organization, it's an organism. It's not systematic, it's symbiotic. Ooh, there's a good one. Two organisms operating for mutual benefit, right? That's the church. The cruise ship is just about being full. Anybody ever been on a cruise? How much weight did you gain? Lots. Why? Because it's all inclusive. You can eat whenever you want. You can eat whatever you want. You can eat wherever you want. You can just eat. And the cruise ship church is all about, I've heard so many people say this, oh, I'm just not being fed there. Really? 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 Not being fed there. I think you're on the wrong boat. Now, I get it. If there's somebody who's not taking due diligence and being responsible to divide the word of God properly, you're probably not being fed by that guy or that girl. But here's what I know. It ain't my job to make sure that your appetite is 100% satisfied for every waking moment of your life. It's your job. It's your job. Your daily devotion. Listen, if I got up here and talk like, open your Bibles to Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
and the earth was out form without void. And God breathed out of it. It was good.
If that's all I did, and you had your daily devotions on point, you wouldn't be saying, I don't feed you. You know why? Because God's word is feeding you. But it depends on what lens you're looking through, right? It depends on what boat you're on. It depends on what boat you're on. Now, what does it result in? If you're on the battleship versus the cruise ship, there are going to be results from this. Because here's what I'm hoping to do. I'm hoping to get you to walk the plank. Not into the abyss. But I want you to change boats. If you're on the wrong boat tonight, I want you to get on the right boat. If you're on the right boat, you're thinking, finally, somebody is saying it out loud. Right? I want you on the right boat tonight. Tonight, not tomorrow, not this evening after you're done, not after you meditate on it for a while. I want you getting on the right boat. Because one boat is sinking and one boat is sailing. One boat is sinking. Have you heard the story about the cruise ship that caught on fire? And they pulled. It was, how long was it adrift? 3 days, no running water, no power. Being pushed by a tug. I bet it got pretty skanky in there. I bet it was stinky and putrid on that. That must have been such a conflict that people was like, this was so nice yesterday. All you people didn't stink like you do today. I want you to get on the right boat. Here's what it results in. If you're on the battleship, it results in having a sacrificial mentality. And you know what? You're not just okay with that. You live for that. You live for sacrifice. And some of you are like, oh, heck no. Go back to Brother Bluto. I want the Jell-O. I want to slurp it off. Have you ever slurped Jell-O, by the way? It's so much fun. This Thanksgiving, if you have a chance, just get a plate of Jell-O in a cube about 4 inches and just slurp it off the plate in one breath. It is the coolest thing. I don't know, Pastor. Sounds like a cruise ship to me. Well, you've not seen Navy guys eat. Here's what the cruise ship results in. A catered-to mentality. A catered-to mentality. Have you ever met anyone with a spirit of entitlement? Oh, good God, does that make you want to hurl big chunks? I deserve this. This is due me. I got rights. You know what my right is? To lay down my life for Jesus Christ and be a sacrifice for him. And whatever he wants me to do. If he wants me to wash dish towels in a laundromat for a hotel chain, I'll do it. If he wants me to preach sermons in soccer stadiums, I'll do it. Make no mistake about it. If you're on the wrong boat, you're going to live with the spirit of entitlement. You're going to walk with a sense of, you owe me this. I've done this for you. You got to do that for me. That's a spirit of entitlement. And you know where that gets you? That gets you unfulfilled quicker than anything else. It also results on the battleship in purpose living. We talked about that earlier, didn't we? It results in purpose living. Look what the cruise ship results in. Drift living. Drift living. Do you know anybody that's drifting right now in their life? You know married people that are just absolutely not happy in their marriage because they're drifting? You know people in their careers that are absolutely beside themselves because they're drifting? You know people that are searching, you know, they've changed their major 11 times because they're drifting? Do you know what the evidence of people looking that turn over relationships like disposable paper towels? It's because they're drifting. People that turn over jobs and turn over cars and turn over purchases and just spin, it's because they're drifting. Hey, people that have purpose don't need it. They don't need it. Just don't need it. What boat are you on? Right? Here's what I believe about this church. The people in this church, they want to be on the battleship. I believe that with all of my heart. Here's what it results in if you're on a battleship. It results in being fit. It results in being fit. Isn't fitness great? I mean, it really, it really bites to have to get there. Trust me, I tell you, I hate working out. I hate it. But when I look in the mirror and go like, yeah, all right, good. You know what, beyond the aesthetics, you know what's cool? Is I can work so much harder and have so much more energy at the end of the day to be a better husband and a father to the people that I love. I'm not fatigued and exhausted and just barricade myself in my room with my remote control. I mean, I just don't. Because if you're on a battleship, you're fit. If you're on a cruise ship, you're fat. That's what it results in. I'm not making this up. If you're on a cruise ship, you're just indulging your appetite. If you're on a battleship, it results in submission to authority. Oh, is there anything more dangerous than a person that's not submitted? Do you know what's very, very frightening? Tyranny. Tyranny is frightening. When there's a tyrant that is unsubmitted, do you know I'm submitted? Do you know I have a boss? I have a district supervisor, a general supervisor, the president of Foursquare. I have bosses I answer to. Do you know what that makes you? Safe. Because I could have plans, baby. Oh, I would build a kingdom unto myself quicker than you can say Bob's your uncle. People that aren't submitted to authority are reckless and dangerous. That's why in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17, Hebrews 13, verse 17, I love this verse. Obey your leaders and submit to their authority. They keep watch over you as men who must give account. Obey them so that their work will not be, that their work will be a joy and not a burden, for that would be of no advantage to you. There's a sense from the heart of God that we, do you remember when you said, oh, I can't wait till I'm 18, I move out and nobody will ever tell me what to do ever again? And you realize how absolutely stupid that was, right? When you're 23 going like, wow, was I ever dumb? But if we don't submit at the heart level, here's what you can trust here. You won't be spiritually abused at this church. There's a lot of people that have been spiritually abused. It might be you. You might have been under the heavy hand of a dictatorial tyrant in a shepherd's cloth. You will not be spiritually abused here. Spiritual abuse is tragic at the minimum and demonic at the maximum. But you're going to need to submit to authority here. Because everyone has to. And that training of, do you ever wonder why God set that up? Here's why. Because the way we submit to authority on earth horizontally is the way we respond to authority in heaven vertically. God has given us authority figures to train us to respond to God appropriately. Do you understand? That's why you have shepherds among you. Now, here's what the cruise ship does. It resists authority. It resists authority. If you're on a cruise ship, you ain't the boss of me. You ain't the boss of me. Who do you think you are telling me what to do? You're any better than me. You ever see rebellion? I mean, really see rebellion play itself out? Never. Did you ever look in the mirror? Yeah. Okay. Pastor, this doesn't make me feel so good as the... I told you, heavy lifting. Told you. These two ships view people way differently. Way differently. On a battleship, you're going to view people as integral. You're going to view people as integral. What does that mean? That means that every single person on your boat is absolutely essential to the mission. There are no inferior rankings. Oh, there's a chain of command, no doubt about that. But you know what? Every good general will tell you that the battle is won with the enlisted men. It's one in the trenches. Every good football coach will tell you, it ain't the flashy receivers and running backs, it's the offensive linemen, right? The enlisted men are the, and the enlisted women, they're the ones that win the wars. They're in the trenches. They get moved and maneuvered by the higher authorities, the non-commissioned officers and then the commissioned officers. But if you're in a battleship, you see every person as integral. Do you know what? Matter of fact, when every person walks into this church, there is instantly a 10 assigned above their head. You're a 10 in my eyes. And you've got to prove to me that you're not before I take that 10 away. And every person that is here at this church, guess what? I see them as being integral to the mission of this church. I don't see any person. Some of you say, well, yeah, you see the millionaires, the guy that got all kind of Johnny Long dollar. He's way important. And this other guy is just on food stamps. Couldn't be further from the truth. Couldn't be further from the truth. Every single person at this church on this ship is essential. You're integral. Why? Because I'm on a battleship and I view you that way. I'm on a battleship and I'm integral. Am I more integral? No. The Church of Jesus Christ has lived through unbelievable obstacles and has survived. But you are integral to what happens at this church. If you're on a cruise ship, you just view people independent. They're not connected. There are porters and there are cooks and there are captains, first mates, and there are engineers. But they're all just not connected to anything. They're not part of anything important to you because you're there to get a tan. Right? You understand? These ships are critical. If you're on a battleship, you view people intensely. There's an intensity that you view people with. If you're on a cruise ship, you view people casually. You view people casually. Do you know what? Every single person in this room here tonight, and every single person at Summit, and every single person at Silver Creek, you know what? I don't view any one of you as a casual whatever. There's an intensity of how I view you. And if you get a hug from me, you know it. If I high-five you, you know it. And that's not just putting on the dog and playing the role. I view you intensely. There's no casual love in my arsenal toward you. My arsenal is poised with intensity toward you. You view every person as essential on a battleship. A cruise ship views people as disposable. It views people as disposable. Isn't that tragic? When people look at people and say, you know what, you're just disposable. If you've lived long enough in this thing called life, you've probably felt disposable, haven't you? At one time or another. You've probably felt disposable. Yeah, we can take you or leave you. Got cut from the team. Didn't get the promotion at work. Didn't get the scholarship. Didn't get the nod at home. You felt disposable. Well, you know what? On the USS Foursquare, you are essential. Now, because here's what it culminates to. If you're on the battleship, and every person that's ever been to battle will tell you this. You develop a sense of family with the people you fight with like no other. And trust me, I have debriefed and talked to people coming back from tours, guys that were in Vietnam, guys that were in Desert Storm, guys and gals that have fought in battles in Korea, and they will tell you that the people that you fight with, there's a sense of a family that exists that transcends blood. I think when Jesus said it best, greater love has no one than this, than they who would be willing to lay down the life of their friends, right? That blood covenant that extends to somebody on a battleship is the steepest and deepest bond that exists on the earth. And only the church can do that. Only. So many people I've heard say, well, the church isn't really necessary. We just kind of show up for an emotional pick-me-up or whatever, but, you know, it's not really, you know what? No. There are things that happen within the context of the church that will never happen anymore. Listen, it's why Jesus came to the earth, to build the church. Not brick and mortar, flesh and blood. Because this is not an organization, it's an organism. It's not systematic, it's symbiotic. If you're on a cruise ship, you know what? You view people as an acquaintance. Have you ever felt used by someone? Just ever feel like, you know what, you sucker, you just used me. You used me to get something you wanted. And I wasn't that significant to you. I'm just more of an acquaintance for you to either be pleasured or promoted, but not really deep. The Church of Jesus Christ doesn't view people that way. There was a guy that came to church here, and he was actually our head usher in year three of the church. And I didn't know this, but he was a predator. And it's before we were doing background checks on everybody and, you know, investigated your, you know, life history. But we do that now, so. This guy was a predator. And he was a crackerjack. He did a great job. He had more people. He had like 75 people on the ushering team. He had like a third of the church ushering. He was amazing. There was a little Korean exchange student that came to the church. And I had found out that he had cornered her like a wolf. And he had been inappropriate with her. And we have a rule at this church. If you're on leadership here, if you're a guy, you do not get in a car with a member of the opposite sex. You do not do it. If you do that, you will be killed, then excommunicated. In that order. Why? Because we just want to stay above the appearance of evil. We want to have no sense of unaccountability. Accountability is critical here. Well, this guy was inappropriate. And I hadn't seen Kiori for, I hadn't seen her for like a month. I'm like, where'd Kiori go? So I found her. I went on a hunt. I found her. And she goes, oh, Pastor Raja, I don't want to make trouble for the church. What do you mean, make trouble? Well, I don't think you would believe me because you wouldn't believe. Give it to me. Come on. Boo-hoo. She breaks down and tells me how this guy, and instantly I was just, are you joking? So I invited him into my office. It's a funny story now. But I looked at him and I said, were you inappropriate with this girl? And he said, no, wouldn't, I can't believe you even suggest that. Da, 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 da. I can't believe you even bring that up. I said, I believe I'll protest this too loudly. I'm going to ask you once again. And by the way, I've already had the interview, and I have 911 on speed dial, and I'm going to hit it real quick if you don't give me the truth. Were you inappropriate with this girl? Well, she came on to me. It's not like I even wanted to, but it's all. She just was so, she's a temptress, and I said, mm-mm. Answer the question. Did you act inappropriately with this girl? Yes. And there was a shepherding thing that came over me instantly. He was sitting with his back to the wall in a chair, and Sarah Koch, is Sheldon and Sarah here tonight? This is a funny story. I love to hear Sarah tell it. Because I came out of my chair, and I punched right by his head through the sheetrock into Sarah's office. And she saw my fist come through the wall. And then I pulled it out. And he's a bald guy. And he had chalk all over his head. And I'm like, oh, good God, I'm glad I missed the studs in the wall. That would have been horrible. And then I said, the first one was a sheetrock, the next one's your face. And I was rearing back, and Rob came in. Rob, my assistant pastor, was, you know, he's a 6'4", 250 guy, comes and tackles me and says, oh, don't go to jail. It ain't worth it. It ain't worth it. And that guy, boom, ran out the back door, never saw him again. You see, the church is not an organization. It's an organism. And you don't view people casually. You mess with one of the sheep here, God help you. We're going to find you. We're going to find you. You need to YouTube that. You'll get it if you don't get it after you YouTube it. But that's, if you're on this battleship, listen, there's a sense, and by the way, that was very righteous. It was righteous indignation, and the fact that I didn't hit him right in the face was because I had a split-second thought of my wife and children and me in handcuffs and going to prison. And that's why I went through the wall rather than through him. Now, phraseology is kind of cool. This one is kind of a cutesy thing that I threw in there. I'm not sure how necessary it is, but I think it's really necessary because it really typifies it's the icing on the cake. There's a Marine battle cry called hoorah, right? Hoorah. If you're agreeing to a command, if you are going into battle, and if you're in the Marine Corps, hoorah! When you get like 100 guys, hoorah! You get that going on, it gets everybody. This, you're not looking with a flashlight, which is diffused light. You're with a laser beam, which is focused light. I've been in that environment. Let me just tell you, it puts chills on your chills. On your chills. The phraseology of a cruise ship is, hooray! 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 Not much focus. Doesn't. It's kind of like the Oregon Ducks. It doesn't breed fear in the heart of people, right? With that mascot. Sorry. I know this is going to Oregon sometime soon, and I'm just, or you know, the mascot. I just picked it. Oh boy, I'm in trouble. But the mascots, like the Wolverines or the Lions or the Bears, but the Ducks, I mean the Fighting Ducks. I don't get it. I'm in trouble. All right, get out of that hole, Raj. Nope. Hey, when the horse is dead, dismount. So I'm off of it. The second part of phraseology that you'll hear is semper fidelis is a Latin term. That means always faithful. Semper fi. Semper fi. The whole Latin word is fidelis. Semper fidelis. You know, write this verse down, and you can look at it later. Judges chapter 7, verse 20. When Gideon is going to go fight the Midianites, and this little guy was like, you know, the mama's boy. And when he went through the whole series of, and like, you know, all the things they went through to try to get out of it, but then he couldn't get out of it because God kept showing himself faithful. There was a cry that the men cried, and it's a great read for you. I really encourage you to look at that. It was Judges chapter 7, verse 20. On a cruise ship, it's just Yahoo. Yahoo. All right. Yahoo. Great marketing campaign, horrible battle cry. All right, listen to me. This is a battleship. You got to go all in. If you're going to lead, if you're going to lead your home, if you're going to lead in your school, if you're going to lead on the job, if you're going to lead in your clubs that you're a part of, if you're going to lead in your city organizational events, it is absolutely critical that you go all in and you get off of the cruise ship and get onto the battleship because you don't want to be like Brother Bluto in any way, shape, or form. All right? All right, all right? Okay, page 41. Page 41. I want to talk to you about delegation. I want to talk to you about delegation. Many people know how to say this word, but they have no idea what this word really means. And we're going to really make it clear for you because I want you to have a great picture of what delegation is and what delegation is not. And I think the more clear you are with delegation, the more fluid and effortless your life is going to become. Do you like that commercial? I see this commercial with this car driving down the freeway with a big boat anchor behind it, and the cop has his radar gun out, and they're shooting it, and the one cop says, let me guess, 7? Yeah! Many of us live our lives with that kind of drag. We have such a drag on our physical energies because we don't know how to delegate. We don't even know what it means. So whatever your idea of delegation is, I want you to shred it, because I'm going to paint you a picture for you to consider. All right? Now, I want to read from you Matthew chapter 10. Write this down. Matthew 10, 5 through 15. Matthew 10, 5 through 15. Jesus sent out the 12 apostles with these instructions. Don't go to the Gentiles or the Samaritans, but only to the people of Israel, God's lost sheep. Go and announce to them that the kingdom of heaven is near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cure those with leprosy, cast out demons. Give as freely as you have received. Don't take any money in your belts, no gold, silver, or even copper coins. Don't carry a traveler's bag or a change of clothes or sandals or even a walking stick. Don't hesitate to accept hospitality, because those who work deserve to be fed. Whenever you enter a city, search for a worthy person and stay at his home until you leave town. When you enter the town, give it the blessing. If it turns out to be a worthy home, let your blessing stand. If not, take the blessing back. If any household or town refuses to welcome you or listen to you or to your message, then shake the dust from your feet as you leave. I tell you the truth, the wicked cities of Sodom and Gomorrah will be better off than such a town on the day of judgment. Now, why did I read this scripture to you? It is because of what Jesus Christ modeled. I want to say it again. What Jesus Christ modeled for us by way of delegation, that we must be superior. We must be superior delegators. We must be superior at delegation. Okay? So if you're going to be superior at delegation, here's what you need. You need balance. You need balance. Now this board, this teeter-totter, is absolutely perfectly balanced. Stay. I want to give you a continuum to work with. This continuum is going to be helpful for you as we go through the process of delegation. And here's what I want you to write down. On the A side of the continuum, I want you to write down the word abdicate. Write down the word abdicate. Now, what does it mean to abdicate? Abdicate very simply means, that is P-U. I don't want to do it. I'm leaving it for you to do. Yahoo. Right? Sound like a cruise ship, doesn't it? Mute the phone. On the other side of the continuum, way over on the other side of the teeter-totter, I want you to write the word dominate. Dominate. When I say the word domination as it pertains to delegation, the word micromanagement should instantly pop into your head. What does it mean to dominate? Well, we're going to get to that in a minute. But the fulcrum in the middle of the teeter-totter, right in the middle, is the critical word as it pertains to delegation, and it's the word participate. It is, in fact, what Jesus did with the disciples. Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, could have very well built the church all by himself with no one else. So why, pray tell, did he take 12 flunkies? 12 Dorkosauruses, if you will. You shouldn't talk about St. John like... John was a fisherman. He stuck like fish guts. Andy Murray and Aunt B come to mind. Opie Taylor. Boom, 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 boom. John wasn't a saint. John was a fisher guy. You ever look in the Puyallup River, those guys standing there, hip waders? Like, boy, you must be outside your mind. What if the water fills up and then we'll just meet you down in Tacoma? What Jesus modeled when he sent the disciples out in this powerful section of Scripture was the thing that we must do, and that is glean the art of delegation by way of participation. Now, I want to give you a working definition, and we're going to go through it kind of quickly. Here we go. Working definition of delegation. The ability to divest oneself from being essential. The essential component in the decision-making process while being present in the process. The ability to divest oneself from being the essential component. You ever drive in the S-curves in Renton? They're affectionately called what? Not the S-curves, but the stress curves. Why? Because all bottlenecks right there in Renton. Horrible engineering of the freeway system. If you did it, I'm sorry. It's horrible. It bottlenecks and it makes a congestion. When everything has to flow through you, the leader, you become the lid of fluidity and operation. You have to open up the passageway to let more water flow through. And the way you do that is by divesting yourself from the equation, but being present in the process. All right? Now, what delegation is not? Abdication. Delegation is not abdication. If you abdicate, you are not delegating. That is not delegation. It's not what Jesus did, and it's not what we should do. The working definition of abdication: avoiding, renouncing, or ignoring the person or subject matter that was handed over by the primary leader. Right? This stinks. I hate this. Who's the lower person on the totem pole I can give this to? I don't even want to think about this. This is stupid and dumb. I'm going to find some grunt that I can hand this over to. Doesn't sound much like a battleship, does it? And it's not delegation either. It's abuse. That is abusive. If you hand over just the crapola that you don't want to deal with because you don't want to deal with it, that is selfish, self-centered, and ungodly. And it's not delegation. Now, what are the catalysts? What's the spark? What's the beginning of the fire to abdication? Well, before I'm too hard on all of us, let's go through what these reasons are. The sheer weight of pre-existing priorities, right? The sheer weight. If you've already got tons of things that you've got to do, doesn't it feel good to get one thing off your plate and off your mind? Just to jettison that thing off your mind. Here's a thought. Rather than throwing it on someone else, why not just throw it away? Rather than throwing it on someone else, why not just throw it away? If you're not going to truly delegate, just get rid of it. The second thing is the lack of concern toward the delegatee. If you don't genuinely treasure that essential person, then you're not going to care to abdicate. It'll be okay for you to abdicate. You have no shame in abdicating. I don't care about you. I don't like you. I don't want to do this. So here you go. Enjoy. Have a snack. Have fun. See ya. Wouldn't want to be ya. Hope you don't get the diarrhea. Eh. The third one is diminutive value on the island on the item being delegated. Diminutive, what does that mean? Small, tiny. I don't care about this. I just know it gotta get done. So somebody else gotta get her done, because I ain't gonna get her done. I think it's stupid. Personally, if it were up to me, I would just throw it out in the heap pile and burn it on fire. But it's gotta get done. If you have diminutive value to the item being delegated, come on. Make a decision. Just get rid of it. Don't do it. If it's that puny and insignificant, find a way to make it go away. Because it's just not necessary if you don't want to do it. Okay. What delegation is not domination. It is not domination. So here comes a working definition. Here comes a working definition of domination. The over-inspection and micromanagement, the over-inspection and micromanagement of subject matter that was handed over by the primary leader. Do you notice that Jesus didn't micromanage the disciples with in this little dissertation that he gives in Matthew chapter 10? Do you know why people micromanage? It's because they don't want some hack screwing up their good thing. Well, I know that I can do it better by myself, and it'll get better done with better quality in a quicker time if I just do it myself, but I can't, so you do it. But you just know this. I'm going to look over your shoulder every step of the way. I'll take the oxygen out of the room. When you're there in the presence of me, I'm going to just be inside your shirt. We're going to be there together working on this thing because I don't want you to mess up my thing because I like it. Domination. Wouldn't you like to work in that environment? Wouldn't you like to lead on that team? What's the catalyst to domination? A pronounced sense of love toward that which is being delegated. You know what? Sometimes we just love things way more than we love people. And let me just tell you, that is jacked up. If there's a pronounced sense of love towards something that we're delegating, that doesn't honor Jesus remotely. A general doubt of competence toward the delegatee. Do you know what I've come to the conclusion of in lo these many years of living? That stuff just isn't that important as we think it is. And if we think someone is just not good at it, so we're gonna give it to them and then look over their shoulder and take all the joy out of their trying. I think some of the greatest things I've ever done in my development is letting people screw up. I'm telling the truth. I love to let people try and fail. Because when people try and fail, I get to come alongside as an instructor and point out the reasons why it failed. And then when they get a hold of it and they get confidence with their competence, oh boy, you should see their purpose begin to elevate and fill. Their sense of fulfillment begins to fill. The third reason is an overinflated value of the item being delegated. An overinflated value of the item being delegated. Hey, I just trust me when I tell you, if things fall flat and break, so what? One thing I've learned about life is there's nothing you can't come back from. If there's breath and blood in you, you can still come back. You know who showed me that? The Mariners. 1995, baby. 13 games back with 1 month to play. And they kept clawing and fighting and screaming and scratching. And they played those nasty Los Angeles Angels, which should be called the Devils. I'm just taking shots at every sports team, aren't I? Hey, there's just nothing you can't come back. There's nothing you can't recover from. I'm in bankruptcy. Yeah, come on, let's go. Let's come back. I've just lost my marriage. Okay, well, that sucks, but come on, let's go forward. Listen, you get a choice to look in your rearview mirror or your windshield. What do you want? You get that vote. Windshield or rearview mirror? What do you want? I want windshield. If you are spending your life looking in the rearview mirror of all your failures and mistakes and the things that have fallen flat, you are going to be medicated. Prozac's expensive. What is delegation? Delegation is participation. Okay, this is where it's going to get good now. Because I'm going to give you some good things to work with. It's what Jesus did. Listen, as we look at the narrative in Matthew chapter 10, and we read those 10 verses, we see that Jesus was very specific. That's Jesus' half-brother. We see that Jesus was very specific when he was... Come on, let it go. It's all right. Sacrilege! No, funny. Jesus was very specific when it came to giving instruction and letting his disciples actually feel the weight of the responsibility of the church. Do you know what I want to do? I want you to feel the weight and the responsibility of the church. Why? because that's where your fulfillment comes from. When you just, listen, you were designed by God on the blueprint drafting table of heaven for a purpose. You were designed with a purpose. You were designed with a purpose. I was designed with a purpose. And the only way you're going to find that is within the church. Well, that seems mighty narrow. Nope, it's single. It's not narrow-minded, it's single-minded. Because it's true. It's why Jesus came. Now, I'm going to give you these are great tried and true principles as it pertains to delegation. What is participation? What is delegation? It is, in fact, participation. All right. The first thing about participation requires timelines and parameters. Timelines and parameters. If you're going to delegate something to someone, hey, whenever I sit down with my staff, I say, okay, where are we with the Christmas service? Well, we don't really know. Okay, well, today is the 11th. By the 17th at 1 p.m., I want a sketch of what Christmas service is going to look like. Okay, right? Timelines and parameters. Because then people can start to work. If you don't give people, listen, basketball is a very exciting game. The Miami Heat are playing the Boston Celtics right now. That basketball court is 94 feet long by 50 feet wide, right? Can you imagine if all the lines were off the court? Hey, I can make this from the third row. Watch this, LeBron. No one's going to pay a penny to go watch that. Do you know what makes it exciting? The boundaries. The boundaries and the parameters make the game exciting. And as it is in delegation, when we give timelines, parameters, and boundaries, you can know that you're setting a good framework for delegation. Now, when you delegate to someone, tell them what you expect. I've delegated mowing the lawn to my father-in-law. I'm wicked smart. And my father-in-law is amazing. Now, I'm very particular about my grass. Good thing for me that he's better at it than I am. But you know what? We have different ideas about mowing the grass. He mows it his way, I mow it my way. If he's going to mow it my grass, I want him to mow it my way. Right? Have you ever met somebody like they have their way, you have your way, you delegate it to them and they do it their way and it makes you mad? Right? You tell them what you expect. Just say it. Here's what I expect, Bill. I want diagonal lines the first 3 weeks and then horizontal lines the next 3 weeks. I don't want to mow the same pattern because the blades of grass get matted down and it loses its punch. I want to change up. That's what I expect. Now, here's the second thing. Discuss why you expect it. Discuss why you expect it. If I were to say, hey, diagonal lines, horizontal lines, you know what he's going to say? You're a jerk. You're a jerk. But here's what Jerry, he says, but if I tell him why I expect it, because Dad, here's the deal. I like to have the grass be, you know, perky throughout the summer. And if it gets mowed in the same pattern, it just gets bladed down. So if we mix it up, it'll make the grass look healthy all throughout the whole summer long. Oh, okay, yeah, cool, great, thumbs up. Now, here's the third thing. Show them how to do it. If you're going to delegate something to someone and you don't show them how to do it, be prepared for chaos and mayhem. Because that grass ain't going to look nothing like you expected it in your mind. Because don't you know that we have ideas in our mind how things should look? And then when people don't do it the way our mind thinks it, we go like, stupid. Can't you read my mind? Don't you know what I'm thinking? Well, no, I don't. So you need to show them how to do it. Then, number four, you make sure they can do it. When you delegate to someone, you have to make sure that they have, isn't that domination? No. That's participation. Because you make sure they have the skill set and the aptitude. Now, fortunate for me, my father-in-law is Mr. Miyagi. I mean, that dude is like, he's crazy. I mean, he does stuff like, my mind goes like, dude, do you know like how good you are? You're very, very good. But if that were not the case, if Bill weren't that good, I would have to make sure that he could do it. And if he couldn't do it, guess what? I would show him. I would show him how to do it. And he would, and guess what? Grass grows back, doesn't it? If you sketch it and sketch it and mess it up, it grows back. Guess what? Same is true in life. It's what Jesus knows. Jesus handed the church to 12 delinquents. Mental midgets. They weren't saints. They were local yokels. But Jesus, right? Jesus made sure they could do it. Now, here's the last one. Make sure they did do it. If you have an expectation of your children to clean their room, and your expectation is, you know what? Beds made, laundry picked up, pizza boxes thrown away. And you don't go into the room for, say, like, 6 months. And you're forcing the door open because of the mound of laundry and pizza boxes and rats that run across their bedroom floor. And you blow a gasket, it ain't on them. It ain't on them. It's on you. Because you have to tell them what you expect. Discuss why you expect it. Hey, rats are a bad thing. And that food on your floor will bring rats. Okay. Show them how to do it. I don't know how to make my bed. It just stresses me out. I pull the covers up. I don't get it. Let me show you. Make sure they can do it. And then you walk down there each day and make sure they did do it. You walk in their room each day and make sure they did do it. You see, when you participate in the process of delegation, it fosters a spirit of confidence. And write this down. Confidence leads to competence. The reason why people, you know what? I am so in paralysis when anything breaks in my car. Anything. If anything goes wrong in my car, I start breaking into a cool sweat. Why? Because I have no confidence in my ability to fix that broken sucker. But I know other guys, you know what? Hey, I need a little Phillips screwdriver and a little tester, an electronic tester, and give me that wire stripper back there, and give me that 15-amp fuse, and we'll have this thing going. Like, wow. I can say it backwards. Wow. I can say it upside down. Mom. I mean, you know. They're so competent because they have confidence, right? Write this down. Inspect what you expect. People respect what you inspect. When it comes to delegation, inspect what you expect. People respect what you inspect. Now, we want to hit inspect what you expect. People respect what you inspect. We want to hit the sweet spot on this delegation continuum. We want to hit the sweet spot. When I was learning the alphabet, right? You remember the song? Sing it with me. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P. Now, stop. I never knew what an elemento was. Elemental, how do you make one of those? Elemental P. What? I don't know elemental. Turn back to page 41. On your continuum, I want you to write to the left of the letter M. To the left of the letter M. JKL. With little hash marks above that line. On the top part of that line. To the left of the letter M. JKL. M. And then I want you to write N-O-P. With little three little hash lines. Now I want you to draw a rectangle beneath that gray line, and then go up and above that gray line and encompass J-K-L-M-N-O-P. Just make a rectangle and put them in a box. Okay? That's not hard to understand, is it? Is that hard? J-K-L-M-N-O-P. Make a rectangle around those letters. A rectangle is a four-sided geometrical shape. Short at the ends, long in the middle. Yes, perfect. Good Lord Jesus. All right. Now, the sweet spot is going to be somewhere in that box as it pertains to different personality profiles. Because you can't treat everybody with M, can you? Because you can't treat everyone the same. Because everyone's different, right? Some people are quick learners. Some people learn a little more slowly. And some people will learn fast with some things and slow with others. So not only with each person, but each instance, you have to find the sweet spot in delegation. Now, first bullet point. This is as much art as science. Be flexible. When you're dealing with people as it pertains to delegation, this is not just, well, the pastor says it's M, so you just get it to M, and we're going to walk through the, inspect what you expect. You have to be flexible. Each person is different. Be discerning. You will frustrate quick learners if you baby and coddle them. You will frustrate them to no end. You will overwhelm people if you just speed read through it and they don't catch on. Be discerning. All projects weigh differently. Be wise. Not everything that you delegate weighs the same. There are certain things that weigh less than others and certain things that weigh more than others. Lives and projects may shift. Be aware. Just because you delegated to someone and you told them what you expect and you discuss why you expect it, you show them how to do it, make sure they can do it, make sure they did do it, things in life are very fluid, aren't they? Life is fluid. Be aware. Projects are all different. Be engaged. You may not unplug just because you delegated. That would not be delegation. That would be abdication. And abdication is not delegation, is it? No. Okay, what is delegation? Very simply, delegation is representation. It's what Jesus was showing the disciples. Delegation is representation. Now, what exactly do I mean by that? Last three blanks, here we go. Projects and people ultimately reflect you, the leader. If you don't like how something's being done, don't get mad at the person you delegated toward. Just look in the mirror. Now, here's the key. Remember, the people are always more important than the projects. When we remodeled this auditorium, Scott Rathbone was our facilities pastor. And he and I would sometimes not see eye to eye on the best way to approach this ginormous project. And when I became frustrated with Scott, which was very infrequently because he did like A-plus work, do you know what I always told myself? Roger, that man is more important than this room. That man is more important in this room. It's what Jesus modeled to the disciples, that the people are always more important than the projects. And I don't know. I think if we get this, we will get Matthew chapter 5. We will get what Jesus was saying. Sorry, Matthew chapter 10, verse 5 through 15. If we get this delegation thing, we will understand what the heart of Jesus was communicating to the apostles as they were building this wonderful organism called the church. I want you to get on board the USS Church. Because on this church, you find your fulfillment, your mission, your purpose, and all the things around you just become solidified and solid when you're on the winning boat.